What are OEE and OCE? First, we should get some definitions straight. When we speak about equipment, we mean anything that runs multiple cycles with no human interaction, making the equipment the gating item. Things like an injection molding machine or automation equipment. When we say cell, it is usually human or a group of humans or workstations run by humans using one or more tools to complete a cycle, making the human beings the gating item. Things like a carpenter or an operator at one or more workstations on the same line. OEE stands for overall equipment effectiveness, and it is used when equipment is the gating item for the output. It is calculated by multiplying three metrics: the availability of the equipment, which could be related to, you could think of it as being related to the lost time due to planned downtime; the performance of the equipment, which could be thought of as lost time due to unplanned downtime; and quality of the parts made by the equipment, which is basically your first pass yield or your roll throughput yield if you have multiple inspection points. These three metrics give you the OEE of equipment when multiplied. I'm going to give you some examples. So availability. Availability is the time the equipment is actually producing versus the time available for production due to planned downtime. Planned downtime can be things like changeovers, periodic equipment maintenance, periodic calibrations, anything like that. Anything that your team does on a regular basis and repeatedly, which keeps the equipment from cycling, and it's usually planned in advance. So if you expect to run the equipment 24 hours a day, but the equipment actually ran for 21 due to planned downtime, then the availability portion of OCE is basically as 87.5%. That's 21 divided by 24. Now you shouldn't just accept this for what it is. You should start looking for ways that you can impact this. There's always a way you can reduce it, especially if you've not really thought about it much before. But that's for your team to decide. But for like injection molding machines, sometimes you can preheat the molds and do a quick changeover to reduce that time. I'm not going to get into details, but use your team to start looking at this. Don't accept it as something that you can't impact. So performance is measured by comparing the actual output to the expected output due to lowered capacity, lower cycle rates, slower cycle rates, or basically any unplanned downtime, short stops, stuff like that. So both conforming and non-conforming product are included in this. We're going to count all the parts that come off of the machine. The quality portion will be taken care of in the next section. We're really just after the performance of the equipment and not so much the quality right now. So when you begin, one of the things that, I need to mention is when you've been collecting data to identify the failure modes for performance and quality or anything like that, you should include the operators in that discussion and put these failure modes in as few groups as possible, which makes sense. So you can prioritize them in the EIC tool. And that's where the operators are going to be extremely helpful. So let's have an example here. So if we have an injection molding machine that cycles every 15 seconds and makes 16 parts per cycle, we would expect 80,640 parts and 21 hours of available time. Now, I want you to notice I did not use 24 hours. I used the 21 hours from your availability because if I use 24, I'd be double counting some issues here. But I don't want to do that. I'm just going to take the 21. I don't want to double count inefficiencies. So you may have several reasons for falling short, and this is where the operators are of extreme importance. Your goal as the leader of the team is to develop a method that the operators can gather the information that only takes them a few seconds of their time every time there's an opportunity on the machine to capture unplanned downtime. Examples of where you may lose production are in the next slides, these examples, not all of them, just giving you a few ideas. So ensure the following are included in your downtime types. These conditions are not really related to the equipment or how well it's run, but they are vital in their own way. You will still use them for calculating your OEE. So one of the conditions is no work or no orders to run. It's not really the fault of the equipment or your team. If you don't have any orders to run, that's good. That means you probably made all your goals for your shipments early, and management needs to know this so that they understand what your available capacity is. They can get more sales, bring more work in-house. So one of the other things is no materials. Now, management needs to know this so they can explain the impact material shortages have on production to the procurement personnel. Okay, think about this. It is important to note that once you begin improvements, material shortages will most likely become an issue. Because if you're able to produce at, say, a 20 to 40% higher rate, you're going to be using materials at a higher rate. So ensure that procurement knows that you'll be using materials at a higher rate as early as possible so they can adjust the inventory levels to avoid running out of materials. Always keep procurement in the loop when implementing improvements to ensure you don't run this risk. You'd still capture this and put it into the Pareto chart. No personnel. Bunch of people are sick. Whatever. Can't really hold it against the equipment, can't hold it against your team. People get sick. They use their vacation time, they use their sick time. And there's nobody there to set up the equipment or do changeovers or whatever. Management needs to know this. But at some point, if not already today, management, line leaders, technicians, and engineers should have standard work and know what to do if an area is experiencing or a piece of equipment is experiencing or going to experience any of these situations. They should also know ahead of time how to react to them. So these conditions should be dealt with in the first 5 minutes of a shift, if not prior to the shift starting. After this, look for unplanned downtime that you and your team can more directly impact, like the examples I'm going to give next. So let's say an injection molding machine equipment cycles every 15 seconds and has 16 cavities, and it's supposed to make 16 parts every 15 second cycle. But let's say one cavity is turned off for quality purposes or whatever reason, okay? Or maybe there's just an error that's been made somewhere, and this results in you getting 15 parts per cycle. This means equipment is performing at 15/16 of capacity or capability, or at 93.8% capability. So one of the things that you can use to avoid this is a control chart of some sort. It should have been in place to alert you that a cavity is going out of specification. You should be able to predict when, and then that should have given you enough time to rework that cavity when the mold is not being used so that you don't experience this type of an error. So you should always consider a control chart to avoid this type of error. You could also have at the same time, or maybe all on its own, the cycle time could be wrong. Let's say it's 15.5 seconds instead of 15. Then your performance is 96.8%. Well, the best way to avoid this is documented processes for how to set up and how to set up the equipment. And not only does it tell the operator who's setting up the equipment how to set it up to achieve the goals, but it tells them what the goals are and lets them know what your expectations are. But don't get landlocked. Don't get locked in place by your documentation. Be open to ideas from operators who set up the equipment. They may figure out a better way over time. Document their ideas and let them try their ideas using a control chart to ensure the impact is statistically significant. You should always encourage your operators to be involved, and you should always trust their judgment, mainly because they deal with this equipment every day, unlike you, who have other responsibilities. You should also never forget that documentation is meant to clarify what is the best process today so we can compare it to new ideas. It is not the only process. It is just what is best today. In order to continue to improve and encourage them to participate, you should get an agreement from the operators that they will try new ideas out after talking with you and the team, and you'll let the control charts or the data decide if the ideas are good, that you're not going to make this decision and that they're not going to make the decision alone. So you might have to train them on what these control charts mean. And there's a video earlier. I'll put a link to it in the description. I just want to spend a few seconds here, minutes, talking about an example that I actually witnessed. So I was qualifying a piece of equipment, and it turns out that it actually ran better at 3.3 second cycle instead of 3 seconds. Now, for many reasons. When it was at 3 seconds, it would move a little bit more and shake a little bit more and cause problems. Conforming parts, it made more conforming parts and produced far fewer non-conforming parts. And these non-conforming parts, they would cost money for us to recover them because we had to get people to take them apart and recover the expensive pieces. So at 3 seconds, our first pass yield was not good. It was at 78%. And we made about 9,600 parts. 7,488 were conforming, 2,112 were non-conforming. And in order to recover the expensive materials out of those non-conforming parts, we had to get six personnel to help recover those parts. But at a 3.3 cycle, second cycle, we made actually 8,727 parts. 7,854 were conforming. So that was just a couple hundred more parts that we made that were actually good. And then non-conforming parts was only 873. So we only needed three personnel to recover the non-conforming parts. So not only did we make more conforming parts, but we didn't have as many personnel on the line, which reduced our costs another way as well. I'm going to go back to these other failure modes and talk about them. So this last one, well, it can be a large category. So let's say you have unscheduled maintenance, short stops, all kinds of things, little things going on, but they total 45 minutes in a day. So you've subtract 0.75 hours from 21 hours divided by 21, and it's 96.4%. Now you see we've got a couple different reasons why we're off here. And all these failure modes, if all these failure modes are happening, then you multiply them to get the performance portion of OEE. So 15 cavities instead of 16, 93.8%. Multiply that by a slower rate cycle time, you have 96.8%. And you multiply that by the short stops and unscheduled maintenance at 96.4%. Multiplying all these three together, your performance portion of OCE is 87.5% of what it could be. Now for the easiest part, quality. Quality is basically your roll throughput yield or your first pass yield after your inspections. This is where you account for your non-conforming parts. So let's say 65,987 parts pass inspection of the 70,584. That's at 93.5% for the quality portion of OCE. The result, when you multiply availability, performance, and quality, is your OCE or OEE is 71.6%. That's not really that bad. But let's go on to OCE. You're going to see a lot of similarities and a few differences. So OCE stands for overall cell effectiveness. It's used for a group of personnel when they're the gating item. It may also be used for a cell having equipment with an OEE if there are some secondary operations after the equipment or some operations prior to the equipment where human beings are then the gating items and you can get the OCE that includes the OEE of the equipment. So like OEE, OCE is calculated by multiplying availability, performance, and quality. But availability and performance, they are a little bit different. Quality is pretty similar. So in OCE, availability is similar to OEE, but it is the daily working hours divided by the total daily hours from the enhanced value stream map. So let's say for two shifts, personnel are in the building for 17 hours. This is what we would put in the enhanced value stream map as total daily hours. But we'll have to remove two 15-minute breaks from both shifts, which is an hour. So we remove remove an hour, and that gives us 16 hours. You take that 16 hours, and we need to remove two 30-minute lunch breaks for each, or one for each shift. That gives us 15 hours. And after removing a 10-minute meeting at the beginning of each shift, we're left with 14.67 daily working hours, which goes into your enhanced value stream map. This is your availability. You're looking at your availability of your personnel. There is a video earlier, I'll link to it in the description, that shows you how to increase this. Basically, your availability, you're talking about the availability of the personnel in the area. So 14.67 daily working hours divided by 17 total daily hours is 86.3%. Performance is the average of all the workstation's performance, which is how each workstation compares to the bottleneck workstation factor in your enhanced value stream map. It also includes any downtime that is not planned. So if you have two workstations, let's say on a line, and the bottleneck is 100, okay, and then the other, let's say it's 100 seconds, and then the other, out of the other workstation is 50, then the bottleneck is at 100% usage, while the second workstation is only at 50% usage. So the average of these two is 75%, and that would be the performance of the line. Multiply this by any one planned downtime that impacted the output, and this is the performance. So an example of some unplanned downtime might be maybe the network went down and you couldn't gather information or put information in. So some of your equipment that was related to the bottleneck made you sit idle for 15 minutes or whatever. One of the things you don't need to be you need to be aware of is do not be alarmed if your performance is less than 45%. This is actually typical if you've never been through a Lean Sigma process. When you're talking about OCE, you often have very wide variation in your cycle times on your workstation factors from your enhanced value stream map. The enhanced value stream map is going to calculate this for you. And it puts the result in the base data tab. So once you do your enhanced value stream map, it's going to give you your availability, your performance, your quality, and it's going to give you your OCE. So look for a link in the description to the video on enhanced value stream map. So quality, again, is basically your roll throughput yield. Let's say five inspection points, they average 92%. Your roll throughput yield is going to be 65.9%. Again, don't get too caught up. There's always this law of diminishing return. So the Enhanced Value Stream Map calculates this for you, and it also puts it in the Base Data tab of the Enhanced Value Stream Map so you can understand it. So you multiply these numbers and you get the OCE, which is basically here, 42.7%. And this is typical of any cell that's not been through a Lean Sigma process. You're going to do the same here to collect data on each area, to put opportunities in the EIC tool so you can prioritize them and begin making the fastest improvements for the least cost with the highest impact. Again, look at the description for a video link to the Enhanced Value Stream Map and the EIC tool. So OEE is used when equipment is the gating item. OCE is used when there are groups of personnel or equipment that has pre and post secondary operations, but basically it's when humans are the gating item. Sometimes OCE will include equipment with an OEE, sometimes not. OEE for a group of similar equipment is basically an average of all of the equipment OEEs in the area. Just remember, also, as you're going through and you're making changes, that things are going to change. You must embrace the change. Some goals for OEE are to be above 85%. And for OCE, your goal should really be to be above 85 or 75%, so don't limit yourself. There are many factors that can make these thresholds higher or lower. Just try to shoot for generally above 85% for OEE and generally above 75% for OCE, and you'll be in pretty good shape. I want to give you an example. Now, if availability, performance, and quality are at 90%, your OCE is 72.9%. So basically, you have to have above 90% for each of these areas to get above 75%. Now, to get above 95% for OEE or OCE, all three of those factors must be above 95%. At some point, you're going to experience the law of diminishing return. Now remember, it's harder to increase by 1% at 95% than increasing 1%. Are from going from 80 to 81% is much easier, basically, than going from 95 to 96%. So keep your EIC tool up to date and use it to find the point where your team experiences the law of diminishing returns. At this point, they must look for some major change in the processes rather than small incremental improvements. So OEE and OCE show you how you compare to perfection, where to look for improvements, and how effective you and your team can be. If you found this video useful, like it, subscribe to the channel, and share it with anyone else who may find it useful. If you didn't find this video useful, then subscribe in the hope that an upcoming video will be. Eventually, we're going to go through projects using Lean Sigma and Six Sigma and the tools to support them. Remember, a wise person learns from their mistakes, while a genius learns from the mistakes of others. So until the next video, take care and keep your data clean.